The current way of life is unsustainable, and things that cannot go on forever won't. All paper assets are built on debt, and have the same fundamental flaw of counterparty risk. The only way to preserve your wealth is to have real, tangible assets. Most commodities have storage or degradation issues, leaving precious metals as the best choice to store a significant amount of wealth in a small area. And silver is the best choice of them all. Gold and silver come out of the ground at a 1 to 10 ratio. They're currently trading at a 1 to 51 ratio. We know that all the gold that has ever been mined has been treasured, and silver for the past few decades has been used and abused as an industrial metal, and massive amount of silver has been thrown away in such small sizes that we have used up all of humanity's silver stockpiles. At some point, the real value of silver compared to gold will be recognized, and the gold to silver ratio will blow through the natural 1 to 10 gold to silver ratio and may overshoot to a 1 to 1 ratio. Throughout all of human history, and even two-thirds of the world today, one day of hard human labor has been valued at one-tenth of an ounce of silver. We can see this in Roman times when Roman soldiers were paid one denarius, or one-tenth of an ounce of silver, for each day they served. Even in China, Sun Tzu said that it would cost 1,000 ounces of silver for 100,000 man army for one day. This is actually 1/100th of an ounce of silver per soldier. Factory workers at the turn of the century earned a dime a day. And believe it or not, two-thirds of the world today lives off of about $2 a day, which is about one-tenth of an ounce of silver. So in a post-fiat world, with limited access to cheap energy and other critical resources, logic dictates that humanity will be forced to find a medium of exchange that is both portable and universally valued. Precious metals have always and always will perform this function. There is no alternative. The ultimate exit strategy seeks to capitalize on this paradigm shift. What you are looking at is a 600-year chart of the value of silver and how cheap it is relative to historical values. I do not know how this chart was made or the methodology behind it, but it is by far one of the most interesting charts I've ever seen on silver. One thing I would like to mention before we get started is that this is measured in 1998 dollars, and you would have to double the value of dollars in the chart to deal with the inflation that we've had since 1998. This chart goes back to 1344. When most mining practices were very rudimentary at best. It was a very labor-intensive process of extracting silver from the earth. There are three phases of this chart that I would like to focus in on. The first phase is from 1344 to 1477. For the purpose of this chart, we'll call it the European Collapse. In 1343, the world's largest banking empire was the Perusian Bardi banking families. They were the first multinational bank with 15 branches throughout the world, including London in the Middle East. Centered in Florence, Italy, they were the center of trade and banking. The gold florin was the standardized coin for trade. Most of it flowed through Florence as a midway point from Europe and the Middle East. To facilitate trade, receipts for the gold florin were used as money. Soon the bankers realized that they could print more of these paper receipts, as very few actually took their gold out of the banks. Over time, the amount of paper receipts to the actual gold florin that was in the banking system rose to almost 100 to 1. Eventually, there was more money that was owed than the real capital. This lasted until 1343, when King Edward III defaulted on his debt that he owed to the banks. This was partly because he didn't have the capital to pay back the loans, and he wanted to establish sovereignty over his land and not the bankers. As a result, England used tally sticks for 700 years, as they did not have enough silver in England. Another point that accelerated the collapse of the Perusian Bardi banking empire was the fact that Eastern civilizations were draining Europe of their money through trade. Muslim and Chinese goods were sold, but they did not want European goods in return, so the balance was settled with silver and gold. This acted as a steady decline of real wealth out of Europe and the banking system. By 1345, the Perusian Bardi banking empire collapsed. With the banking system collapsed, there was no money for trade. It did not take long before commerce was disrupted all over the continent. Without trade, there would be no money for seeds, and food didn't get planted. Soon people starved and social contracts were broken. This eventually led to the plague and the Black Death that nearly wiped out 25 to 30% of the European population. It was so bad that people resorted to eating tree bark, and they were too weak to even bury the dead. People like Ben Bernanke worry about the Great Depression, but that would actually be the best case scenario. Because when world commerce stops and credit stops, food and fuel will stop. And once you introduce scarcity into a world, people get crazy. Not only will they break their financial contracts, they will also break their social contracts. The Peruzzi and Bardi banking empire was a worldwide fractional reserve banking empire that went bust. When the debt became so large that it could not be serviced, people wanted their real capital out of the banks, collapsing the illusion of wealth. Under the hundreds of paper claims on the wealth, there was no real wealth to be had. As anybody who is smart pulled their gold out of the banking system before people realized that the jig was up. This is very similar to where we are now. Paper assets are levered on top of each other in this paper Ponzi scheme. Paper money is leveraged for loans for consumer debt, which is levered to commercial loans for businesses, which levers the real estate market, which levers the government tax receipts, which levers the bonds, which levers the derivatives. And all this debt funds the mechanisms of control that this empire has built. Only real tangible assets provide a safe haven out of this collapse. The collapse of money leads to the collapse of commerce, food, and population. Immediately after the banking collapse, the price of silver dropped in half, but I don't believe that tells the real story of what happened to silver. In the collapse of that proportion, the nominal value of silver may have dropped in half, but if all other assets drop by 90 to 99%, you have actually doubled your purchasing power. This is evident when churches began melting down their bells and religious artifacts to make money, as it was so desperately needed in the economy. As the economy recovered, the nominal value of silver then went up 400%. This came at a time that European silver production peaked in 1384. What is interesting to see is that silver peaked at $806, measured in 1998 dollars. Using today's dollars, it would really be about $1,600 an ounce, since the dollar has lost about half of its purchasing power since then. The next period on this chart is 1477 to 1804, and we will mark this as European dominance. During the collapse of Europe and its eventual recovery, silver became scarce relative to the amount of goods, but that scarcity would soon change. Europe did not fully recover from this collapse for close to 100 years after the Perusian Bardi banking empire collapsed. This resulted in Europe falling behind the rest of the world as other civilizations grew massively. It was not until strong sovereign rulers realized the power that they had to shape their reality and change the dynamic of their kingdoms. Sovereigns took full control over the money and the religion in their lands. In England, we saw the rise of King Henry VIII. France, we saw the rise of Louis XII. The Holy Roman Empire had Charles V. And Spain had Queen Isabella and King Ferdinand. They created business-friendly empire policies that sought to create trade built upon honest money without the influence of bankers. What started out as a way of trying to get better trading routes with Asia through the sea turned into a massive find of new wealth and power. Because Europe was so desperate to find new wealth through trade, they found the New World. They soon realized that they discovered a new amount of wealth and a relatively primitive nature of the indigenous population. And what started out as trade quickly turned into exploitation and genocide. This exploitation and colonization of the New World by the Europeans resulted in an importing of a massive amount of real wealth as it was stripped from the North American continent. Gold, silver, and other commodities were imported from lands and people without the need to trade. This one-way exploitation deal built the amazing cities and capitals that Europe is known for. This funded a global empire that spread throughout the world. This growth led to military growth and more wars for resources and control. This period marked a true loss of purchasing power of silver, as the supply of silver rose dramatically through the use of slave labor and exploitation of the New World and other markets Europeans dominated, like Africa and India. In 1545, the Potosi mine in Bolivia was opened, and it was the largest silver mine of all time. The mining of the mine was one of the most disgusting crimes in human history. It was said that the amount of silver that was mined out of this mountain could have built a bridge of silver from Bolivia to Spain, but it is also said that they could have built another bridge of the same length with the bodies that died mining that silver. I have seen reports where over 8 million Bolivians died in those mines from the barbaric mining practices and exploitation. The average miner only lived to about 35 and usually died of scoliosis, mesothelioma, accidents, and poisonings from various noxious chemicals that are used in the mining process, like cyanide, mercury, and carbon monoxide. One thing I would like to point out during this time of European exploitation was that China remained outside the influence of European dominance. And even though they had no domestic silver production, they went on to reportedly accumulate 40% of the world's silver through trade. The ambition and free trade practices of China allowed them to accumulate so much wealth through trade surplus. I hope you are starting to see the similarities from this chart and where we are today. The Perusian Bardi banking empire was a global Ponzi scheme that collapsed. Other nations not dependent upon the Ponzi scheme recovered quicker, like China. Real tangible wealth is needed to start up the system again, along with a free and fair economic playing field. The Europeans relied upon debt and death through slavery and wars to increase their wealth, while China used trade to accumulate almost 40% of the world's stockpile of silver. This is eerily similar to where we are today, with the European Ponzi scheme, built upon debt and death, coming to its end, and China holding most of the world's wealth. The next phase of this chart is the Industrial Revolution. The exploitation of world markets gave capital necessary for the Industrial Revolution. One of the key factors of Europe's growth during the Industrial Revolution that many people don't consider is that energy resources, namely coal, were near populations that could exploit it. China's coal reserves were much further inland and not easily near the coastal population. The combination of capital, energy, and population gave a boost to Europe, as it solidly eclipsed China as the largest economies in the world. This did not make China poor, but it was not as advanced as the Europeans. Even though the British created an empire that the sun never set upon, China still had 40% of the world's silver and was very wealthy despite that it was not modern and certainly did not need modern manufactured goods from England. This resulted in a huge silver trade deficit for England, as it was drained of its silver as it imported tea, silk, and china from China. I will go much further into this story later. But essentially, Britain fixed the trade deficit with China with drugs, debt, and death. The British East Indian Company imported opium, made by the Thugian Indian, into the ports of China that not only caused problems for local Chinese governments, but it drained the silver from China. It finally escalated into two opium wars that stole the wealth from China, as China could not compete with the more modern and devious Western powers. The next major development in silver was the crime of 1873. Where Rothschild agent Ernest Sayed bribed enough politicians to demonetize silver in 1873. This essentially made all debts that were owed harder to pay back, as the money of people was no longer acceptable in payment of debt. This new gold standard thrust America into the most brutal deflation that resulted in 90% of the money taking out of circulation, and is probably the worst time to be alive in U.S. history. The demonetization of silver was a powerful ploy by the bankers, as the huge silver discoveries came online in western United States like the Comstock Lode. This newfound silver would have made America debt-free from all the new silver dollars that were going to circulate in the United States. But with the demonetization of the new silver discoveries, it only served to depress the price of silver and gave more power to the bankers that owned the gold, the debt, and the politicians. By 1913, the major bankers were even losing their debt and gold to the growth of the United States in the West. Most of their banks were centered in the East, but all the growth was in the West. As the United States grew, local banks were popping up all over the country, and businesses were now using profits to fund expansions instead of debt. The creation of the Federal Reserve put a stop to that, and it had affected America with monopoly debt money to control businesses and other banks. With the bankers firmly in control of the game once again, they went about creating more debt, and nothing creates more debt better than war. Wars were concocted to provide power and profit to fuel the debt-based illusion. And when real wars were not made, they created wars on ideas like drugs or poverty. This resulted in a sick symbiotic relationship where bankers created debt money and politicians spent money in debt. As a result of this new reality, the private banking power had silver relegated to industrial uses. It was deprived of its investment and monetary demand all over the world as humanity entered into a debt and death paradigm. This industrial use increased as the price of silver was suppressed and controlled and was treated as a cheap industrial metal, so much so that we've blown through most of the major stockpiles of silver that humanity sacrificed so much for. In 1950, it is estimated that the United States had 5 billion ounces in their strategic stockpile. Now there are none. It is sick to think that millions of lives had suffered and died for silver in the Potosi mines and are now callously thrown away into trash heaps. During the 1970s, paper money was dying, with the explosion of commodities like gold, silver, and oil. People like the Hunt brothers sought to protect their wealth from the Rockefeller banking and political power in New York and Washington. They wanted to keep their wealth in real things like silver. I have already covered what happened to the Hunt brothers in previous videos. One thing I wanted to point out that their loss was a symbolic loss for real wealth versus paper wealth. No longer did Americans see wealth as things that came from the earth, like oil, cattle, land, and gold, like they saw in long-running TV shows like Dallas. It was now a new era of paper peddlers, like Gordon Gekko from Wall Street. Those that sell the biggest lies make the biggest money now. Those that provide no real tangible value for humanity make millions of dollars a year. Those that have the most psychopathic and short-term plan stepped all the way to the top of power everywhere. This is the kind of world we have been in since the Hunts lost their battle in 1980. 32 years of increasing debt and degradation of society as humanity adjusted to the cutthroat nature that developed when sick people control societies. The good news is the system is reaching its mathematical and cancerous end. Our money is corrupt, our politicians are corrupt, our banks are corrupt, our corporations are corrupt, and the cancer of malinvestment has spread so far that it will kill off the once vibrant host. Cancer might see itself as a superior force like our current rulers, but cancer cannot survive without a host to feed on. We, on the other hand, can live much stronger when we don't have to carry this cancerous paradigm on our back. We are the ones that have to deal with taxes and regulations and divorce courts and crappy jobs, and yet we still are able to eke out a decent life. The criminal elite cannot function in a world where they cannot prey on innocent people by selling them lies to sacrifice for their cancer. They need us. We don't need them. This is what the silver bullet and the silver shield seeks to do. Empower people to walk away from this cancerous paradigm before it collapses, and to accelerate it by deleveraging their illusionary wealth system.